Alrighty. Hi, Carla. Welcome to the podcast. Can you tell
Hello.
us a little bit about yourself?
Yeah, of course. So I am a veteran of LaSalle. I've been around for around 7 years, and both as a student and as a staff member. So I actually, for most of my college career, I worked full time. So I went to school part time, and just graduated with my bachelor's in 2018, and now I'm in a transition into graduate school.
That's super exciting. And what did you study while at LaSalle in your undergrad?
Yeah, so at LaSalle, I was a double major in religion and psychology. Now I'm in a professional clinical counseling graduate program. So I have that perspective to bring to my students and really relate to having a lot of commitments and having to make things work, going to school and also trying to make things work at home with work. So I definitely empathize and have brought that perspective to my meetings.
Right, I'm sure, because now you were a success coach. So I helped with the interviews recently, but you were a success coach previously, right?
I
So
went.
you have been a success coach pre-pandemic. So I know that was one of my questions, but I'm just thinking you could talk about like why did you choose to be a success coach, and does it feel the same now that we're online? Like it's totally different, I'm sure.
Yeah, so I have been part of LaSalle's team for a while. So as a staff member, when I was in Dean of Arts and Sciences office, we had been talking about bringing in success coaching to LaSalle as added support for students. I was very interested from the beginning when I heard that that would be an opportunity. And when I'd even heard what a success coach was, I had no idea of what it was before. So I was really excited from the beginning. To me, it was a no-brainer. I went through LaSalle as an undergrad. Now I'm doing grad school, which I started during my first year as a success coach, and helping students get through LaSalle and get the rewards from getting a LaSalle education, it was a no-brainer for me. So pre-pandemic, it was a lot different to kind of summarize things. Pre-pandemic, we did get that interaction that I feel like a lot of us are missing right now. So we would see students all the time. I would walk with some of my students to Starbucks. We would have our meeting while we walked, then come back to the office with our coffee. I'm a big coffee junkie, so
Me too, me too.
yeah. So there was a lot more interaction. I would get to see students in the hallways. If I hadn't met with some of them, I would get to
Right.
say, "Please remember to schedule with me," or "Do you have time right now? Let's go to my office." So it does feel like a different world. Now in Zoom,
Yeah.
we're getting used to things, and I think we've gotten a lot better at them than we were at the beginning. And things feel a lot more natural now that we're getting more used
Right,
to.
it's like reality now. Like when I first, so I'm a ch I was a tutor, like a regular subject tutor, my last year, which was last year. I'm a 2020 grad, and then I became a professional STEM tutor, which on one hand it works for me because I'm at grad school at Rutgers, so it would have been very difficult, I think, to be at LaSalle and Rutgers. So on one hand, it's nice because I can still be a tutor, but on the other hand, like I used to be booked with tutor, like the anatomy and physiology kids, like. All day I would have tutoring sessions. Now I get like one here and there. So I think it's starting to become the reality, especially this batch of students that are freshmen, because they didn't know different. Like last semester I had kids, like sophomores, who would meet with me every week. And then as soon as we went online, I like didn't see them. And I was like, I'd reach out, they used to meet weekly. It's just some people, they're not comfortable. But this incoming class, I think it's because it's all they know. They're like, yeah, I'm going to tutoring. I'm going to tutoring. So I did see a little like spike in the beginning, but I definitely agree. I miss interaction. These interviews have been really fun because I think I only have like a few meetings a week. Otherwise, it's like me sitting around reading. I'm sure you know all about reading in grad school. It's like what we do. But yeah, no, that was a really good answer. So what success strategies did you use in college? And now that you're on the other side, would you look back and think, ooh, I would do this?
Yeah, so I actually before today, before this interview, this meeting, I was going back and kind of really thinking about what did I do, how did I get through it with everything that was going on. And one big thing that I know I did from the beginning was meeting with professors. So to go over feedback on papers, I would do it plenty of time. I'm an overachiever, so when I would see B plus, A minus. I'm like, I would go to what did I do wrong right away and speak to the professor to make sure I understood the feedback and make sure I could improve that for the next time. That's something I did. And I didn't realize until kind of looking back that it's something I consistently did, just taking advantage of that opportunity of the one-on-one interaction with the professor. They would get to know me better and they knew I was interested in improving. And I would get to learn a lot from seeing the feedback on the paper and asking them exactly what things meant if they weren't clear. Another thing that I'm finding that I do a lot more now is just making connections with peers, finding a couple of other students in the class that I connect with. I think in graduate school, it might be a little bit easier because we're all, I won't say we're all older adults. There's a lot of us that are pretty young in graduate classes, but I would say that it's a different mentality. Like we're all like, the worst that could happen if I reach out to a peer is that they say they're too busy or they say no, and then I move on to the next person.
There's like a different, I don't want to use the word maturity, but I agree. There's, I had a group project and I dreaded group projects in high school and even college. I had some group projects where it just didn't work. And again, it's hard when you're in grad school, everyone has the same goal. When you're an undergrad, that's not always the case. You might have colleagues or like classmates who aren't sure they want to be doing this major, or for them, it's just another elective. They're checking off their list. So for them, a C is like they don't care. You know, I had someone who was like ready to drop out and I was just like, well, I can't. We need to do this. Whereas I just had a grad school project that was really hard. It was a coding assignment. None of us were computational, like we're all science, like bio, and we worked so well together. And I said at the end of the day, I was like, you know, I know that we might not have done the best job because we're not the most experienced, but I am so thrilled with how everyone interacted. So, and like, I think like you said, I'm not saying that's not achievable in undergrad, but like you said, you need to find like-minded people to build those support groups. So yeah, that's really good advice. And then going to see the professor, I agree with you. Like when a student would come with an essay and say, oh, I don't know why they took off this point. And I would say, we could sit here for 3 hours and talk about like why I think they took off that point. But if you want the answer in 7 minutes, maybe two, you got to go see the professor. Like we can sit around and we can discuss, which is good, because there's a difference between that peer-to-peer talk and student-to-professor. Like I always went and saw professors too, but it's intimidating at first. So I always say, come see me. We can sit here and talk about it, but then go see the professor because they make your exams. They grade your essays, they grade everything. So those are two really great pieces of advice. I really agree with both of them.
Yeah, and it's a great thing that you mentioned that the piece of it being intimidating to speak to professors and using peers to kind of have a role play and practice before you actually speak to the professor. So your meetings, when you have it with them and they bring feedback to you and you go over it with them, and then preparing the step further that I sometimes do with my students is, what is unclear about the feedback? Tell me exactly what your questions are about this. And kind of preparing when you go to the professor, because they're going to want to know what exactly is confusing to you.
Yes, they don't want to hear, I don't understand. Professors hate that. Like when you're sitting in class and someone's like, I just haven't been following the past week. That is not the way to speak to a professor. So I agree, going to a peer or like a tutor or a success coach to talk. I think it was Reg who told me he likes to proofread emails for his students. That's a great feature of like success coaches, because no one teaches you how to write an email. It's something you learn through experience. But if you never did it in high school and you're a freshman, emails can convey things very poorly or well. So like if you're really frustrated and that comes across in an email, it's not going to be perceived well. So that was something interesting that I never thought about, having a peer review an email before you send it.
Yeah, absolutely. And a lot of times we get questions like, so what should I say? So after having the conversation of reach out to professor, ask about this, reach out to the tutor, and not kind of taking a step back at times and thinking to even ask, are you comfortable with sending that email? Do you need help? But I found a lot of times the question comes back, so what should I say? And that is when what Reg said, proofreading emails for students or giving them language that they could use for the email. So giving them an example of some of how you would ask for help or ask for a meeting. So that's been really valuable for us to do with our students for sure. One more thing I had about strategies that I use is looking for a distraction-free zone. That's getting harder and harder to do with this online only, mostly schooling. But I use the library, and we still have Connolly Library open.
Oh, I didn't know. Great.
It's still open. It's still available. I use the library a lot as I was getting to through my undergraduate degree. And especially the third floor, which is the quiet floor, I would be up there all the time because I knew at the time at home, I wouldn't be able to focus. Yeah. Things were chaotic. So to everyone that feels like things are chaotic and is able to get to campus, the library's open, there's private rooms where you won't have to be worried about someone else coming up to you because COVID. So that was a great resource for me as I was getting through things.
Yeah, I used to go to the library too. Another thing though is just finding a space. Like I was in Holroyd all day for all of my classes. So they have little lounge areas. Like if you can just find a space that isn't your house, like currently I am doing grad school, I'm working two jobs all online, and I am in a house of six people and like two dogs. It's stressful. Like even like I used to go to the coffee shop, like Starbucks or even my local coffee shop, just sit down, it's quiet, you put your headphones in. So yeah, it's definitely, I think that's important. And again, like you said, if you don't have your own room, like I didn't until right now because my brother's away at college. I usually share a room with two people, serious. And like, so you have to find a spot. And if that spot's on a park bench and you use your hotspot on your phone, like you have to find a space because if you're constantly distracted, you're not working efficiently. Like, so yeah, that's really good advice. So what are some of the biggest mistakes that students make in their first semester that you've seen?
The biggest mistake I've seen, and it's one that's very easy to fix, is not reaching out to all the wonderful resources that they already pay for to have on campus. It's kind of strange to phrase it that way, but it's true. You're paying for all these amazing resources to help you get through your first semester, which is so difficult to get through, and your first year. Us success coaches are assigned to every freshman at LaSalle, and we definitely would love to be seeing more students than we are. Same thing with tutoring, same thing with academic coaching, same thing with our amazing counseling center. There's so many resources on campus, and feeling like you're alone getting through your first year, that's the biggest mistake students make, being in isolation through their first year, because it's a difficult one to get through. And they have so many amazing resources available to them that they're not using. And that makes a huge difference in the first year. So that's the biggest one. It's the easiest one to fix because all of them have access to Starfish that could go on it right now and schedule a meeting with either any resource that they need that they've been putting off doing. But that's the biggest one I've noticed by far.
I have to agree, and I always start my, not the first time, I was in SI for six semesters. So the first one I was not as like confident, but after that I used to get in front of the class the first day and say, it's not that you can come, it's that you have already paid me. You have already paid me and every tutor and every coach in that building. So if you don't go, you're wasting money. And no college student wants to hear that. That is like, and I did not use services until probably junior and senior year. And then I started tutoring and I got like counseling. I did the whole thing and it was free. Never again after this are you going to have free tutoring and counseling ever. Like, it was so crazy that it opened up. And students, I think there's like a stigma that if you get tutoring, you're not as smart. I used to emphasize that I will be tutoring someone in biology. And there were days that I'd do 30 minutes to them, and then I'd pop in the other chair and do 30 minutes with someone for organic chemistry. I was not good at chemistry, but I loved bio. It has nothing to do with your intelligence. It has to do with your determination to get a good grade. And I had one student who ended up becoming a tutor. She's really great. Most of my students literally got the highest scores, higher than me, in the classes they came to me for. So for some people, I think it's a confidence thing. They want to hear me tell them that they're prepared. Totally fine. I love doing that. For some people, I had a student before who came in with like a stack of scattered papers and the exams and TDs. Not my favorite appointments, but I'm happy to, like, I was happy to do that too. So again, and it's, you already paid me to do it, so I'm happy to do it. I always tried to emphasize that the same way you did, because no one wants to hear that they're wasting money. So if I kind of pressure you into going to your first one and then you end up loving it, then that's fine with me.
Yeah, and I love that you mentioned that, just the motivation piece, the confidence piece, that you just let them know you're on the right track. That's also a big one. And I've also found that a lot of times they're just not giving themselves enough time. And after meeting with a tutor, realizing, oh, studying for this takes so much more time than I've been giving it. Mm-hmm. And that makes a huge difference. So tutoring not being about, I don't know what I'm doing, just being, it's about not knowing how to do things effectively yet.
Right.
And once you realize that, it makes a huge difference. So
yeah, and yeah. I found a lot of my sessions were more like strategies, not, many aren't content. Like I would have a few students say, can you explain this cycle to me? We can do that. But a lot of it was strategies too. And I also like to say, like, if you need to study, if you tell yourself, I need to study 8 hours for this exam, consider your hour of tutoring and your hour of SI, consider that studying. Anytime you go and you talk and like read the material, because a lot of people, that was something they told me, like, oh, I don't have time to come to SI. We fill out a survey. I used to say, like, we fill out a survey in the beginning, so you better, like, so I know it fits in your schedule. I have access to your schedule. I know it does. And you better be putting in at least 1 hour of studying. So I tried to kind of make it like, don't consider this some additional thing. Because I felt that, like, I worked multiple jobs and had classes and I was in clubs, and having the thought of like adding another thing to my life, it's unmanageable sometimes. But if you consider it as already being part of something, like, I already have to study, I might as well do it with someone who's taken the course. And, you know, so yeah, I agree with everything you said. Those are really good tips. So now getting back to your job now. So in your own words, what is a success coach and who do you think can benefit from scheduling an appointment with you?
So in my own words, to summarize what we do, I would say that success coaches are student allies and mentors. So a lot of what we do is listening to our particular student's story and listening to what brought them into that room, virtual room with us, and seeing in what areas they just haven't considered certain things that can help them either improve or give them that permission to set a goal that maybe they're feeling overwhelmed by and feeling like maybe that's too high of a goal to set. So having someone to mentor you to the process, having someone cheering you on to get to that next level. That's how I would describe success coaching, just having an ally, a mentor, someone you can count on to give you the resource, to kind of point you to the resources you need, but also a listening ear to really motivate you to set those goals for yourself that can sometimes be intimidating. Who can benefit from success coaching? All of our freshmen who have us assigned to them. And our conversations are so, they could be about so many different topics. Some students could be doing well academically, but financially it is very confusing and they need help decoding some of that, or maybe thinking about all the options that were given to them. Or it could be so many different things. It could be doing well academically, maybe not so well emotionally, and need someone to talk to and see what's best, what could I do in this situation. And then there's, of course, students that are struggling academically and they just need someone to talk to because they feel like they're stuck and want to figure out where things could be going next. So yeah, all of our freshmen, because if academics isn't what's an issue right now, there could be other things. I know right now we're seeing more students being interested in how to get a summer job. So even something like that, you're doing well, things are going well, but what do I do to start looking at how to get a summer job? I'm interested in internships. It could be so many different things. So all of our freshmen that have us as a resource could benefit from seeing us in some way. There's so many different things that we could help them with. So yeah, everyone that has this assigned, you could benefit in some way by seeing them.
I like the term ally, because that's so, like, I think of all the times, everything you just said is a conversation I've had with, like, a roommate or, like, a boyfriend. So, and I know, like, when you start stressing out and talking about, it's good to talk about your stresses, but when you keep talking to the people you have relationships with, it can be, like, really hard on them. And they don't always know what they're saying. Like, they're not professionals. So the fact that we have access to these professionals who aren't going to be, like, our relationship isn't going to be dampened and, or, like, made everything's heavier now because I know she's, like, stressed out and I don't want to be able to go somewhere, like, disconnect from your home life, disconnect from your personal life, and talk to someone who's still an ally and has your best interest in mind, because that's hard to find. It's hard to, I think it was Jose or Reg, it's hard to find someone unbiased. Mm-hmm. And then Reg had said, I wouldn't even call us unbiased, we're biased towards you. So it's really hard to find someone on your side, because not that everyone has, like, ulterior motives, but the fact that your job is to be on their side, the student side, that's, like, a really good person to have in your corner. So I'm really excited about this position. So to end, I have a serious question and then a fun one. So the serious is, what is your biggest piece of advice for students in college? And focus on what is, like, one thing that they can do today to start their path to success.
I think I mentioned, I went into this a little bit earlier, but the first thing, the most important thing that you can do is use the resources available to you. It's an easy one, can be started today. One thing that I have here, if you're maybe not sure, not bought into the idea of making a meeting with the resource, I think what someone could do, one of our students could do right now today, would be start reflecting on what it is that I want to get out of my college career. Why is it that I'm here? What is my purpose with getting a college education? I find that sometimes when students aren't doing well, they haven't been able to connect that with that bigger piece. Why is it that they want to do this? It's a lot of money, a lot of time, a lot of effort. Some disappointments will come your way inevitably in the 4 years as you try to get through this, or longer. Sometimes it takes longer. Mm-hmm. To not know why it is that you're doing it, that's when motivation starts to tank. So if you're not sure you want to schedule a meeting with any of us yet, although we'd love to have you, I think that reflective piece is a huge one. Start thinking about, I'm struggling with motivation, but why is it? Why am I here? What's that bigger purpose for me? Why am I taking this difficult journey if I don't know why? So that's my preaching moment of the day. That's what I have.
Yeah, and I think, like, if you were to ask a lot of students, why are you here? The answer would be to get my degree. But I think you're right. You need to reflect beyond that. Like, so what, like, what does a piece of paper mean to you? I think so many people focus on, oh, I just need to get the degree. Well, what are you going to do with that degree? And what is the experience behind that piece of paper? Because, like, I think of all the research I did. If you look at that degree, someone who just took, not, and nothing, everyone has different paths, but someone who just took courses, no extracurriculars, no jobs, no experience, we have the same piece of paper. Theirs probably has a little bit of a higher GPA because they probably weren't as busy. The same piece of paper. And, like, you have to, I agree, like, reflect on, why am I doing this research? Why am I, like, why am I building this resume? Why do you want your degree? Because it's not enough to just be like, oh, like, I want a bachelor's, you know, like, what do you want to do with that? So I think reflecting is, and again, if you're just saying, oh, I want a degree, that's not going to give me motivation.
It is not. That's the huge piece of this.
Mine's like, it's not even, it's like up in this corner. It's not even framed. Like, I do not even think twice about it. But now I think about, I'm in grad school, I'm doing research that I really enjoy. I feel really, like, fulfilled. And so did I know I was going to do this in undergrad? I don't know. But, like, that is my motivation now. I don't care about my degree moving forward. So I think about, like, it's motivating because I have a project and I want to find the answers to my questions. So I think reflection is a really great piece of advice. And my final question, what are you currently binge watching?
So I had not watched Game of Thrones when it came out, and it was a craze. Yeah. So I binge watched it and I couldn't stop watching. And I almost stopped watching a few times because I was horrified.
See, the end of season one, I was almost, or was it episode? There was one like in the beginning and I was like, what?
The end of season one, yes. Mm-hmm. But I had no idea that it gets so much worse.
Oh, it's, yeah.
So I did finish it. It's kind of embarrassing about how much I binged it daily. But I finished it. Mm-hmm. And right now, what I'm watching is the Chappelle Show. They have it on HBO. Oh. So I started watching it because I had never watched it. Although I've watched both, like stand-up things. So, yeah.
Do not need to be embarrassed because my boyfriend and I watched all of Game of Thrones in 1 month over winter break. It was disgusting. Like the amount of time I sat, I think it was like junior year of college, so whatever, not the last season. And then my roommates and I had a Game of Thrones like finale party. We got the Game of Thrones wine. We got the Oreos that came out during that time. Like it was so gross. So glad to put that behind me, but that is a phenomenal series. I actually read the first book. I'm like halfway through the second. I haven't had any time to read, but if you like reading, they're like this big, but they're really, it's fun to read the backstory. So
okay, my partner actually wants to read the books.
Yeah, I highly recommend. Now we're getting like way into detail, but one thing I've gotten to an argument about with like a friend is that they read the books first and then watched it. But I argued that there is no way I could have kept all the names straight reading it. I needed like the picture because there's so many names, so many people. I needed like the visual from the show and then reading it. I'm like, oh, I know what they look like. But they argued, no, you have to form your own opinion. So I don't know. So for your partner, you can like, I don't know if they watched it already, but.
Yeah, my partner and I watched it together. And
oh, so he doesn't have an option. Okay.
He was saying, maybe we should watch the first couple of seasons again because I didn't know anyone's name. So it's interesting that you say that.
Yeah. I actually did watch it twice. The first time, like junior year. And then before that last one came out, I was like, I didn't know anything. So I need to be a quality show for everyone listening. I definitely recommend it. Probably not children approved or whatever, yeah. Definitely adults only, but
18 plus, please.
Yeah, I feel like 50 plus. Sometimes I was watching it. Well, it's been lovely. Thank you so much. Thank you for dealing with the technical difficulties. This was lovely.
Thank you. This was great. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it was really nice to meet you and have some like interaction. So enjoy your weekend.
You too.
And I will hopefully talk to you soon.
All right, take care.
Bye.